the turn of the 20th century, a group of British and German scientists considered this possibility. They embraced a theory put forth by early Greek philosophers that all life in the universe began in one specific place. This theory is called panspermia.
Panspermia is the theory that life formed in one place and then got spread around to other places. In outer space, in the medium between stars, we see molecules that are the building blocks of life. So it's easy to get the building blocks of life to another planet. For example, if life formed on Mars, it could have come here to Earth, contaminated Earth, and then started life here.
Roughly 3.6 billion years ago, Mars was warm and wet, much like the conditions on Earth today. Biologists believe that because Mars cooled more quickly than other planets, life may have developed there first.
Mars is a better candidate for life during the early part of the solar system. Mars rocks are coming here all the time, and these have been knocked off Mars by asteroid and comet impacts. And we know that they could convey any Martian microorganisms to Earth.
In August 1996, a team of scientists made a stunning announcement. A Martian meteorite found in Antarctica contained evidence of fossilized life. The 4-pound rock, designated ALH84001, showed the presence of carbonate globules excreted by microbes when they were alive on Mars 3.6 billion years ago. Earth was no longer alone. Life had existed elsewhere in the universe.
So this cross-contamination between Mars and Earth, which 20 years ago was regarded as a rather wild conjecture, is now pretty much accepted by the astrobiology community.
Astrobiologists studying the origin and evolution of life in the universe embraced the possibility that life on Earth began in outer space. Did modern-day scientists finally prove what ancient cultures have believed for centuries?
The common myth or idea that the origins of humankind is from the stars is widespread. Ancient cultures had the ancient Egyptians, the Mayans, the Aztecs, the Indians, and so forth, is intriguing. And it's probably true. And I mean it from an astrophysical point of view. We do come from the stars. It's a fact that life on Earth has been seeded by the coming of a comet containing the life matter.
I personally suspect there is life out there. In fact, I believe that we have evidence, if nothing else, microbial evidence for life extraterrestrially.
But if life did land on Earth from outer space, was it by accident? Or might it have been sent here on purpose? One mainstream scientist thought so. British geneticist Francis Crick is best known for his collaboration with James Watson. Together, they unraveled the structure of human DNA in 1953. Less than 10 years later, they were awarded the Nobel Prize for their groundbreaking work in genetics. In the 1960s, Crick became a proponent of panspermia theory and took it to a whole new level with an idea he called directed panspermia.
Francis Crick hypothesized that somewhere perhaps on the other side of the galaxy, there had been a civilization of advanced intelligent beings. And they had found that their planet was going to be destroyed. Perhaps a supernova was going to go off in their vicinity, and their planet would be sterilized of life. And he asked himself, what would an intelligent civilization do in that situation? Well, first of all, they'd try to figure out if they could get out of there, if they could actually preserve their lives and the lives of their descendants, perhaps crowd into spaceships and fly across interstellar space until they found a suitable planet to colonize.
But could it actually be true? Could we really be the descendants of an alien race that traveled here from another world?
The ultimate implication of some exobiological theories is actually that we ourselves are extraterrestrials, that life on Earth arose because organic material was brought here from elsewhere.
What if we're the ones, the descendants of those who came from another planet? We weren't created. We were brought here, seeded planet Earth as a colony from some other planet. So we're colonists of another race, and that's why the aliens look like us.
In my opinion, it's not unscientific to consider the possibility of ancient astronauts, alien intervention. We live in a huge universe. Now, bacteria versus humanoids, one may say that's a big difference, but in some ways it's not a big difference. Where you have life, you have the ability for that life to develop into what we consider civilization or intelligent beings.
Is it just a coincidence that modern science and ancient alien theory have come to the same conclusion? That life on Earth came from the stars? And if it's possible that billions of years ago, an extraterrestrial race spread out across space, how would they survive in their new home? Could they really be our missing link? For thousands of years, mankind has tried to depict alien beings who they believe came from the skies. Many of those creatures seem to share characteristics with humans. They often have two arms, two legs, fingers, and a head, just like we do. Biologists refer to this basic body shape as bilateral symmetry.
Bilateral symmetry is very simply, you divide something down the middle into two parts, and lateral means up and down, and the two sides are an exact reflection of each other. If you fold the thing in half, all the parts line up.
Bilateral symmetry evolved relatively early in the evolution of animals, several hundred million years ago.
But being bilaterally symmetric allows you to be streamlined and to develop a head end, so you become cephalized, and that certainly happened in vertebrates. Virtually the mouth at the end of something, and then you get progressive development, and that seems to have led to many, many advances.
So when you look at it closely, you can see a lot of advantages coming in. Having the two arms and the two legs to work together really give you great mobility and balance and speed. Having eyes on two sides separated give really improved vision in various ways. Animals that are predominantly prey use their two eyes independently and get a huge field of view. Animals that are predominantly hunters have them more in the front and get really good depth perception, which you need if you're going to land on the animal you're hunting.
If it is true that aliens resemble humans in their physical characteristics, might there also be genetic similarities? Could we even be related? In 2003, the U.S. government announced that the Human Genome Project had identified all of the nearly 25,000 genes in the human body. For the first time, scientists had a roadmap to the genetic makeup of humans.
Human genomes are the ones who are transmitted from parents to children. Each human genome, that is the one that we get from our father or the one that we get from our mother, has 3 billion letters, 3 billion components. Everybody thought that would open lots of possibilities to study human heredity and perhaps for medicine and other applications.
In 2006, genetic researchers at the University of California at Santa Cruz discovered an area of the genome they called HAR1 that appears to be unique to humans. Scientists believe the HAR1 gene plays a critical role in the advanced development of the human brain and is a key element that sets us apart from other animals. But where did it come from? Did humans develop this distinct gene naturally through evolution? Or did it land here from another planet? Francis Crick, the British scientist who helped discover the structure of DNA, believed that human genes could not have evolved by chance.
Crick didn't feel in that period of roughly 600 million years from the formation of the planet down to the time when the planet could first support life, there was enough time for DNA to evolve by accident. It's an enormously complicated molecule. Crick gave this analogy. You would be more likely to assemble a fully functioning and flying jumbo jet by passing a hurricane through a junkyard than you would be to assemble the DNA molecule by chance in any kind of primeval soup in 500 or 600 million years. It's just not possible.
But if this molecule could not have evolved accidentally, how was it created? Was it, as some believe, put there on purpose?
The question should not be, do the extraterrestrials look like us, or what do the extraterrestrials look like, but do we look like the extraterrestrials? Because according to the ancient astronaut theory, a long, long time ago, extraterrestrials came here and through a targeted mutation of our genes, we quote unquote became human.
Possibly, there's information in our DNA about whether human evolution was manipulated or not. The DNA is almost deciphered, yet we only understand 5% of the information it carries.
Welche Informationen unser Erbgut trägt?
Geneticists have determined that it only takes about 5% to clone a human being, and that 95% of that genetic material that we have in our bodies is nothing more than what they refer to as genetic junk.
Why is everything there? And there's probably parts of the DNA that don't have an obvious current function. Maybe they're left over from something that was used in the past, kind of like our appendix is left over.
Could this genetic junk hold the key to the evolution of humans? Some people suggest that decoding our DNA entirely will unlock startling information about our origins. But could it even prove that aliens played a role in our development thousands of years ago?
If you hypothetically wanted to record an eternal message that could be decoded by a creature that had eventually evolved enough intelligence to decode it, and the place to put that message would not be on some monument or in some text which might be swept away, but actually on the DNA of the creature itself. It's recently been established that DNA is a recording medium of almost limitless power. It would be technically possible to record the entire knowledge of a civilization on the DNA in our bodies. All you'd need is a way to access that information.
I think we have something, the whole humanity in our genes. Somewhere in our genes, it is coded that extraterrestrials were here thousands of years ago.
Nobel Prize winner Francis Crick published an extraordinary book called Life Itself, in which he argues from a scientific point of view that life, the DNA molecule, which is the essence of life, could not have got started by accident on this planet. He didn't believe it could. He compared it to, he said it's about as likely that, you know this idea of the primeval soup and molecules accidentally bumping against each other producing life, which so many of our scientists mm-hmm, like?
Sure.
Crick compared that to, thought that was about as likely as the assembly of a fully functioning jumbo jet by a hurricane in a junkyard. It is just such an extraordinarily complicated molecule, the DNA molecule, and its relationship to the proteins equally complicated. So to cut a long story short, he suggested it was sent here by an alien civilization from the other side of the universe who faced certain doom, perhaps, as a result of a supernova explosion. They sought to preserve the essence of life, and so they sent bacteria out into the universe in spaceships loaded with DNA. Those bacteria, one of those spaceships, crashed into the early Earth. This theory is Crick's theory. It's called directed panspermia. Its cargo of bacteria spilled out and started reproducing and evolving and eventually became us. And that's honestly how Francis Crick, the Nobel Prize winner, saw the beginning of life on this planet. Now, if by chance he was right, and we can't dismiss that, the man won a Nobel Prize, after all, for the study of DNA, then we have to consider another possibility, which is that that supposed civilization on the other side of the galaxy that sent DNA to this planet may have genetically engineered that DNA. It's recently been discovered that DNA is a fantastic recording medium. Patents are being taken out all over the world to use DNA as a recording device, that it would be possible to record vast quantities of information on DNA. Right now, today, our scientists can record 100-word songs on DNA, and it's been done on the DNA of the E. coli bacteria. But the evidence suggests that its storage capacity is limitless, perhaps even enough to record the entire knowledge of a civilization. So that's the idea, that maybe on so-called junk DNA, which is 97% of our DNA, only 3% of our DNA is involved in genes. The rest, we don't know what it does, and the scientists call it junk DNA. Maybe that contains and has contained since the beginning of evolution recorded messages, interactive recorded information from our makers, waiting for the evolution of a creature that would be able to understand those messages and decode them. And the suggestion is that creature is us, and the decoding method is altered states of consciousness. So this is a parallel possibility that I review in Supernatural, along with the possibility that spirit worlds are real, which I repeat is my favorite of the two possibilities.
Well, I think I was first interested in science when I was a boy. And it's very difficult to remember as far back as that. But as far as I can remember, I was interested in science. And it wasn't something that I got from my parents, because they didn't know anything about science. But they were very helpful, and they gave me a book called The Children's Encyclopedia, which I read avidly. And then I wanted to do experiments, and I sort of blew up things in bottles and tried various other things. So it goes back, really, I think, to the general curiosity I had as a child, and my discovery that there was something, you might say, called science, which you learnt about the world. I don't think I have a special mind. I think I have the sort of mind that most scientists have. They're curious about the world, and then they learn the way of approaching things scientifically, which is not a natural way of doing things. It was a very, almost a freaky way of doing things. The Chinese never really discovered it, for example, nor did any other civilization. It started probably with the Greeks, but it really developed in Europe with Galileo. All the people before that, they don't sound like real scientists. They sound like people who were groping towards scientists. But Galileo sounds like a real scientist. His words are sort of, he uses the arguments one would use today. He knew how to do experiments and how to argue from experiments, and he knew how to erect general principles, as it were, to explain the experiments, not just a re-description in their own terms, you see. And I don't think that's particularly natural. I think that's what you have to learn. The curiosity is natural, but the method of explanation is not the natural one. Our hunter-gatherer ancestors didn't need the scientific method. They needed rough and ready rules of thumb so that they could get by and generalize quickly from one instance and make the right decision. You know, it was more important to make the decision than to actually know the exact reasons you were making it. That's very unscientific, you see. Now, it is true that when you come to the choice of a scientific problem, you have to do that. You have to use a sort of more intuitive approach. You can't explain exactly why you think this is a good one and that is a bad one. You may give some reasons, but it's not obvious that they are the real reasons, as in many other things of life. The reasons people give are not necessarily the true reasons that are motivating their brain, you might say. But nevertheless, the actual way that you approach it and the way you try to disprove theories, for example, by doing well-designed experiments and doing what are called controls, which the ordinary person has no idea really what a control is. It's an experiment done to rule out some rather simple other alternative explanation. That's called the control. You know, the typical one is the man who drank gin and water and whiskey and water and brandy and water, and every time he got intoxicated, so he decided it must be water. Well, to a scientist, that isn't a joke at all, because he should have done the control and just drunk the water. Science is very different in this way from what most people think of as knowledge and what they know. The thing you know in science is never absolutely right. You can never say that. It's the best interpretation you have at the time. But some interpretations are so good that it's probably foolish to doubt them most of the time, so that you don't doubt them. It has a much higher degree of certainty than most ordinary knowledge, which people think is certain, but isn't. Right. So that scientists really do live in a quite different intellectual world from the majority of people.
This isn't at all generally understood, I don't think.
No, I don't think so, of course it's understood by most scientists, but for people who are non-scientists, that's not, there's a lot of intermediate people who are interested in science, and some of them would understand it. A lot of non-scientists don't think that particular way. Thinking in a scientific way is not necessarily a natural way, it just happens to be a very effective way. It's not even very effective for one person. It must be groups of people doing it, because otherwise you get trapped in your own errors and having other people. So that's why you need a consensus of people to agree on something scientifically. To have one person is fallible. I won't say it's a group, a number of people are infallible, but they're less fallible. The errors tend to average out, shall we say. Well, I didn't actually learn the thinking at first, you know. At the first, you're just satisfied by learning about all the strange things in the world. And there are two aspects of why the world is strange. One is that it's strange on the surface. I mean, a giraffe is strange the first time you see it. And no doubt the first time you look through a telescope and see stars or more clearly, or see there are more stars. There are lots of things which are just simply observation which are strange. But many people have that experience. You don't have to be a scientist to appreciate all that. The other strangeness is the underlying simplicity of much of the world, which is not apparent from the complexity we see. And this is basically because our brains have evolved in terms of what our ancestors experienced on the one hand and what our own experience was. Our brains have devolved so that they only look at a rather narrow part of what constitutes really the whole universe. They only look at a certain small range of sizes. They don't normally look, for example, at things you can only see in a microscope, let alone things which are much smaller. They don't look normally at things which are much bigger. I mean, most people had a pretty vague idea how far the moon was. They have distances which are really Earth distances. Well, when you look at the sizes we know, from the very, very tiny things that you get in the interior of the nucleus of the atom now, right up to the size of the universe, you realize we only see a small, very window of that. And the same with time. We have a time of experience, which, again, we hardly appreciate anything which is shorter than a millisecond, a thousandth of a second. It's usually in seconds, minutes, days. Even 100 years is not, we can grasp. But 1,000 years, we have to be almost taught. But the great length of time, for example, of the age of the Earth, which is shorter, of course, than the age of the universe, 4.5 billion years on the one hand, and the very, very, very short times which physicists deal with these events, usually with very small matter and so on. Again, it's only a very small window of time. So we only see, and our brains have evolved to deal handily with that. Now, when you want to understand the world, you have to go beyond those narrow limits, both in up and down, both in space and time. And then you find that there's a uniformity and extraordinary things happening which you'd no idea of just looking at the world. And this is the fascination of science, really, I think, to uncover so much which is not apparent just in everyday life. Well, I think it's stripped the world of the wonder that people had in the past, but it's replaced with a new sort of wonder, in my view. This wonder of the very small and the very great and the very short and the very long and all the strange objects and behaviors you find in between. Now, one of the reasons I think that people think it's inhuman, which is the other thing they say, is the most highly developed sciences at the moment are not the ones which are closest to us as people. They're physics and chemistry. Chemistry in particular seems to have got a very bad name among people. To say something is chemical is a terrible thing to say, apparently, although they're made of chemicals. It's bizarre when you think about it. So when biology, since the introduction of molecular biology, has also become a hard science, but it still hasn't got up to the brain and our feelings and our perceptions and things of that sort. And these are still in a half-scientific world where we don't have the insights and the explanations. Consequently, when people learn modern science, it appears rather detached from the things that they, as persons, are mainly interested in. But that isn't going to last another 100 or 200 years. We shall understand people's behaviors and what it is that makes them think in this way and feel in this sort of way and so on, rather than the rather crude rules of thumb we have at the moment, because obviously we do have rules of thumb, otherwise we couldn't interact as social beings. But they're not necessarily the accurate ones. It was just the same in physics. There's a sort of physics called Aristotelian physics, after Aristotle. That's what the ordinary person believes in physics. If you ask them questions, they answer as if it was Aristotle answering. They don't answer as if it's Newtonian physics. I mean, people do experiments on this. But even with starting undergraduates often get the things wrong.
What would be an example of that?
Well, the answer is if you were flying along and you dropped a heavy bomb from an aeroplane and so on, where would the aeroplane be when the bomb hit the ground? Well, the correct answer is most people think you leave the bomb behind. You see, well, you do a little bit because of the friction of the air. But leaving aside the friction of the air, the fact is the bomb hits the ground immediately underneath the aeroplane. You see, and that it's the business of making reproducible observations, which can be done by other people. They're not necessarily repeatable, because sometimes it's a unique observation, but it may be one of a similar type. It's when you look at one star and then look at another star, for example. It's making observations. It's setting up some theoretical model of what is happening, which nowadays in these mature sciences is usually related to other scientifically established things. It's not in isolation. And then trying to make further observations or do experiments, if you can do experiments, to try and confirm or disprove these general ideas. And I don't think you normally do that when you look at it. That's not the way the ordinary most things are done. If we take the case of biology, for example, we don't know how you build a hand. We believe we understand a lot of the principles involved. We don't think there's anything deeply mysterious, but it's a very complicated operation in which we have to unscramble just all the detail way the molecules interact in order to get the structure shape of a hand with the bones and the nerves and the right number of fingers, which of course sometimes you get people with an extra finger and so on. We don't understand developmental biology. That'll probably be understood, I would say, within a relatively short time, tens of years. And the other thing that we particularly don't understand is the way our brains work. We know an enormous amount about bits of our brains and psychological things, but they don't click together in a picture, so that in such a good outline picture that we could answer the sort of simple questions you would ask, such as what is memory, or what happens when I see a red ball, or something like that. We can't really answer those questions yet. And the final question we have to, final broad subject that we have to address in biology is the whole nature of evolution. We think we understand broadly the evolutionary process, but we certainly don't understand it in detail. How can we understand how you evolve a hand unless you know how you make a hand now, for example? So we have all those things. So there's an immense amount of biological knowledge, let alone all the practical knowledge which will come out, how to get better crops, better treatment for diseases, and so on and so forth. We think we understand the general principles, but we don't really understand exactly why this one step and that. Let's take a case. What was the evolution of language, just to take a thumb, which is very close to us? And we don't know when it originated, we don't know what happened, whether it did in stages or this, that, and the other. So although it may be all you can say, wave your hands, and it was done by natural selection, that's the principle involved, but what you want to know is when it happened and what were the steps by which it went, because usually evolution goes in a series of steps. A complex thing doesn't evolve all in one go, usually. It usually takes one step, and then it takes another step, and then a further step, and so on, as far as we can tell. But naturally, we only have the rather imperfect or very imperfect historical record for that. We can't go back in time and look at dinosaurs and so on. We only have very fragmentary information. The more genetic information we have now, the more we understand about development, the easier it will be for us to try and track back in time to see what the various steps were. And some of them go back a very long time. For half time that life has been on the Earth, all that was here was bacteria. You know, that they're the only things around for the better part of 2 billion years. And then there was some step which, as it were, multicellular organisms, or eukaryotes, as they're called, they're not quite the same, those two, began to evolve. And again, we would like to know what happened with that step. So there are many, many steps, and of course, eventually we'd like to know how life originated. And there's work going on in the Salk Institute and other places as well, of course, on the origin of life. But it's very difficult because we don't have any of the evidence. We've got very little. We have no molecular fossils, and yet it was clearly a molecular event. And so we have to try and deduce it from the principles of chemistry and having bright ideas. So there's many of those things. Now, you could argue the origin of life is so long ago, and may have been a rare event, that it may take a very long time to understand that. But the origin of language, I would have thought, was much closer, and there are a lot of things in between. The borderlines between the living and the non-living, what we would now call molecular biology, and the action of the brain, in particular what we call consciousness or awareness, because those at the time seemed deeply mysterious and didn't look as if you could easily explain them. They seemed to be, and after some struggling, I decided I'd work on the borderline between the living and the non-living, and essentially that's been cleaned up in principle. There's an enormous amount of work in working out the details and so on, but in principle we now understand that. It's no longer mysterious. But the other one, which I then took up when I came to California, how the brain works, on the other hand, is still very mysterious. And for a long time, I didn't bother about the problem of consciousness. I just wanted to know what was known about the brain and about the parts of psychology and so on, so I could really begin to see the problem from inside the subject rather than looking at it from outside. And in the last few years, I've got the feeling now is the time we should come to grips with this problem, in the visual system anyway, of how we see things. And I'm beginning to notice other people are now saying the same thing. I think they might have done anyway, but I expect that Christoph Koch and I, he's the man I mainly work with, have given them a little push in that direction, because it really wasn't respectable to talk about it before. It was thought to be either a problem which you had to leave to philosophers, or one you couldn't do experiments on, and how we would define it, and a lot of things which we think are irrelevant. So what we've been hoping to introduce is a new approach to the problems. Of course, we'd be very much happy if we had not only a new approach, but a solution. But so far, most of the ideas we've come up don't look what I would call specially convincing. Maybe one of them is right, and we don't know yet. So we have to keep going and working a little harder. The techniques in terms of molecular biology are really rather backward and rather slow, but that's because the system's very difficult. And molecular biologists happen to be very good at developing these techniques so that they work on a much faster timescale in molecular biology than they do in the so-called neurosciences. That's the one thing. The other thing is we don't have a good set of general principles. We know certain things about the way neurons send out signals. We know and roughly the type of signals they are. But we're very unclear how an individual neuron actually collects the signals and decides whether to send out its spike or not, for example. When you come to the action of very many neurons together, very many nerve cells, then we don't understand that at all, really. We're just groping with explanations and feeling our way. We don't have what you might call the overall organization of the brain. We know there's a bit here and a bit there and a bit there and that they're connected, but are not very clear exactly what this job does. Now, when you come to the different parts of the body, that's not true. We know roughly what the liver does. The liver is the organ of the blood, is the classic way of saying it. We know that. We know many of the operations that go into it. It isn't the only thing concerned with the blood, because the heart pumps the blood, for example. We know all those for the major organs of the body, but when you look at the subdivisions of the brain, we really don't know the answers. We have provisional guesses, and probably some of those will be on the right lines, but we don't have good, crisp answers, which you think are likely to be fairly stable for some time. Now that's why it's going to take much longer. I think you get a feeling for the complexity of a single cell, and particularly a nerve cell, of course, which is more interested in all sorts of cells. But I think you can, because you have to realize, you have to just sort of scale everything up in your mind and try and think of the cell in terms of the molecules in which it made up. And when you think it that way and think how many different types of molecules and how they interact and how they're arranged and all the arrangement of the membranes of the cell and the filamentous particles and things like that. But you have to be able to think in terms of the molecular level. Well, what if you're used to thinking about atoms and molecules so that they're like objects of everyday life? There isn't any particular problem in imagining the complexities of a cell. You should think of it this way. It isn't that the cell is small, it's that you are big. You see, you should start off with the atoms of which everything is made, and the atoms make up the molecules, which are not that much bigger than atoms. In terms of diameter, there's only less than a factor of 1,000, say, between a very big molecule. It depends on the shape. But when you start from the atoms, of course, which is where I think you should start, then you see that it is necessarily a very complex object. And then you have to realize that you are made of an enormous number of cells. So it's only if you start taking an everyday point of view that you think the cell is small. I don't think of cells as small. I think of them as large, at least in some contexts. I don't honestly think about subatomic things. I just have to go down to the atoms, as a physicist would have to do. Well, I never thought of myself as exceptionally gifted because I always sort of had to work away to pass exams and do this, that and the other. And I certainly wasn't gifted in things like languages. I had quite a job getting through school certificate French, I remember. And I was hopeless at Latin because I couldn't bring my mind to focus on it, what it really came to, I think. Because I was really so bad, there must have been some instinctive hostility towards it. So I thought I was sort of averagely bright, but I'd never thought I was anything very special, and I don't especially think now. I think it's partly a matter of luck, you know, in some of these things. You hit on an interesting discovery, and you get encouraged, and you go in a certain way, and you might well have not had that piece of luck, and might have turned out differently. course we were lucky. We just happened to be in the right place at the right time. But we were thinking in the right sort of way, so it wasn't just as we just stumbled on it accidentally, as if you were going for a walk and found a buried treasure, a lot of money or something on the ground. I mean, we were looking for something. We weren't just wandering around aimlessly. But I think possibly the other thing is that I've been very lucky in the people I've been in, had as close friends, and I think I've been influenced by them. And also some of the older people I work for, I think I was lucky. I don't think in my case there was one special person who made a large difference, but I think there were several people who made a considerable difference. For example, when I in the war, when I went and worked in the Admiralty, I worked with a group of people headed by a man called Massey, Professor Harry Massey. He seemed to be a very venerable figure to me because he was a full professor, as they say here, and he was a fellow of the Royal Society and so on, and I thought he was... It turned out he was 34, I think, at the time I worked out afterwards. But I thought of him as much older. And it's interesting that I don't think I was aware especially of being influenced by him until I heard him give a talk many years later at a dinner of the Royal Society. And he gave, instead of giving a sort of rather frivolous after-dinner talk, he gave a quite interesting and serious one. To my astonishment, he kept repeating a lot of my ideas. Well, I realised he hadn't got the ideas from me. I got them from him, you see. But I hadn't realised I got them from him until I heard him talk that way. So you can have a lot of influence of that sort. I knew I was influenced by him, but I didn't realise quite to what extent. And I was certainly influenced by Bragg. The younger Bragg as a crystallographer, and also by Linus Pauling, but that was a more indirect influence, not so much a personal one, but just following the way he did his work. So there are a number of influences of that sort, but there wasn't, I think, one person who made an enormous difference. There were several people who made a considerable difference. It's very difficult to give advice, because we have this, of course, for the young people who come here once a year or so to the Sulk, because the Sulk has a thing, one Saturday, I think, where they have pupils from the local high schools come, selected ones, and they get some talks and shown around labs and what goes on. Well, what one tends to say is rather platitudinous. You say you shouldn't go into science unless you're really deeply interested in it, unless you feel strongly, because the work is very demanding. I mean, you have to work long hours and so on. You don't necessarily get paid very well, certainly at the beginning. And unless you're really vitally interested in it, you'd want to go on and do something else. So that's one of the things that one does. When you come down to more practical things, well, you should say, well, I think it depends on the individual person. Then you have to ask them, which bit are they interested in? How mathematical are they? How do they like using their hands and things of that? Then you have to go on from what they say to give them perhaps some advice in that direction. But really, when it comes to more detailed advice as to about careers, as to which university they should try to go to, I wouldn't be the person best qualified to do that. And there are people who do give that advice. That's a natural part of the scientific career, but you understand in order to be accepted as an apprentice, you have to show that you've done well at exams and you have to give the impression that you're sort of reasonably hardworking and that you're bright and all those things. And obviously, therefore, if you get taken on with a very good school, Harvard, Stanford, Caltech, a number of other ones of that sort, the chances are that you'll then be sufficiently qualified to go stay there, or usually in America, go to another place where you'll work under somebody, and that is your apprenticeship. When you're working for your doctorate, I mean, the so-called graduate student in the scientific world is the lowest form of life, really. He's the one, he is the apprentice. He's like the apprentice who fills in the little bit corner of the picture that the master allows him to do while he's doing the interesting parts, as they did in the Renaissance and things like that, you see. So, and then when you've got your PhD, then there's usually another year or two when you're what's called a postdoc, a postdoctoral, and that's a very crucial part of your career, because again, you have to get usually go somewhere else, not always, and taken on. And up to, now you're beginning to choose what you want to do rather than what was suggested, you see, and that's when you begin to practice. Of course, some people are so good that they can accelerate that somewhat, but that's the normal course. So you certainly serve an apprenticeship. It would be very difficult to do scientific research unless you did it with someone, because not only a lot of little tricks and things to learn, but the whole scientific attitude has to be absorbed. And what you do about publication, and nowadays what you have to do to want to get money, you see, which doesn't happen automatically by any means. You have to write grant requests and so on. One of the things, fortunately, I've never had to do is the question of raising money. Because when I started after the war, there was more money around, and anyway, it was the business of more of the people one stage above me, more senior people, to get money. Science was expanding. We were supported by the Medical Research Council. And from a number of years, money wasn't a serious limitation. Then, of course, there was a period came when money was very tight. But by that time, I was no longer doing experimental work. I didn't need as much money, therefore. On the other hand, and then it was easier, because by then I got a sufficient reputation to get money in much more comfortable ways, like having an endowed chair, as I have here at the Salk Institute. So I haven't had that, but I've seen younger people. This is a very severe stress, in that they can sometimes only get money for 3 years. They have to, and so they have to choose something that's going to produce results within the next the 3 years that's coming, and before that's finished, they've got to start to write another grant request. Sometimes now it goes for 5 years, or occasionally for seven. So money was more serious. On the other aspects of learning how to do research, yes, I certainly had to learn that, and I didn't at first. I mean, when I started really more on my own, but I did learn from watching Bragg and some of my other colleagues. But I think one of the other things which I haven't mentioned that you learn is when you have fairly close friends and to discuss things with them. And this is really, for most people, there are a few people who work best in a solitary way, but for most people, and certainly for scientists, I wouldn't like to say for mathematicians, certainly for scientists, it helps to have one or two close friends with whom you continually talk about things, because, and often you could talk an enormous amount. This is what I did with Jim Watson, and this is what I did later with Sidney Brenner, and also with this mathematical friend of mine, George Kreisel, for example. All these ones help you to see how to go about problems and prevent you getting stuck in a rut, so that it's really part of your education, talking to your contemporaries, as well as having the apprenticeship. Well, it depends, of course, what it is. Of course, it's rather different if you're doing experiments, because you may have a collaboration where one is an expert at one part of the technique and another at the other, and you work together in that way, and so on. So that's one way. But, of course, if we're talking about more ideas and things, yes, it is important to be candid and not to be afraid of saying something silly. And equally, when whoever it is you're talking to says something, it's your obligation to try and show what's wrong with it, as well as appreciating whether it's a good idea or not, you see. So that this comes quite naturally to people, especially younger people. And of course, it does help the tradition that you have, especially in America, of not showing undue respect for your elders, which is a great handicap in Japanese science, for example, where it's not polite to contradict the senior person.
Do you expect respect?
I much prefer it when somebody contradicts me, as long as it, in a reasonable number of instances, they turn out to be right. If somebody contradicts me constantly, was constantly wrong, I wouldn't particularly enjoy that. But I don't feel I'm getting anywhere in the discussion. And this gets more difficult as you get older, because younger people are more reluctant to, or don't think it's worth their while, or things of that sort. So it is more difficult.
I suppose that your collaboration with Watson, it's one of the great, and it's difficult perhaps for you to put yourself outside it, but it is one of the great collaborations, isn't it? Like Hardy and Littlewood?
Yes, except it didn't go on for such a long time as Hardy and Littlewood, I think. I mean, it was mainly the 2 years that Jim was there the first time, and then a little bit later when he came on a second visit. And then when he went back and resumed his job at Harvard, it isn't that we didn't see each other and so on, but there wasn't the close interchange. It does help very much if you're together in the same place.
So your collaboration with Sidney Brenner would be more...
Well, in that case, of course, we were sharing an office, but of course Sidney was doing experiments a lot of the time, so we weren't in the office, you know, the whole working day. The test I used, which I stumbled on, was to see what it was I was gossiping to people about. What you're telling people, what you gossip about is what you're interested in. And that's what I found I was telling them about. So I decided that's what I must be interested in. And exactly how that interest arose isn't very clear, except that they are two of the things which appeared mysterious. Unless you answered them, you had to accept a more religious explanation, which I was reluctant to do on general grounds. So I think that was the key thing that made me choose those two things, those two areas of biology. And some of the areas which one might have gone into, I didn't want to go and in work on certain parts of physics. I didn't think I was good enough as a theorist. And some of the experimental parts for getting things for teamwork and didn't look so interesting. So there was no particular appeal in what I did, little I did know, which wasn't very much. So it was very easy to make a change. So it was a very unusual situation. Very few people find themselves in a situation like that. Well, you're constantly driven by your curiosity and you're constantly frustrated. So it's a bit of both. I don't know, it's like asking an explorer, what happens if you're exploring a strange bit of the world? Hardly any bits left now, but in the past, say, exploring a bit of the Amazon jungle. Obviously, it's dangerous, it's interesting, you don't know quite what you're going to discover. It's a mixture of all those things. It must be, in a certain sense, reasonably pleasurable. You wouldn't go on with it. You see, I mean, if it was thoroughly distasteful, shall we say. But it's not unalloyed pleasure because you're not getting any feedback of getting results, you see. Much easier. The ideal thing to do is if you do experiments in which every few days you get a nice positive answer, and then you go on and do another one and get a positive answer, and you get reinforcement all the time, and then you're really very cheerful and happy. But in this work, certainly. And that's why it helps if there are two of you, because if one of you gets a bit downhearted, the other one is probably, you know, in a more buoyant mood and carry you along. But it's not to be recommended for everybody, I can tell you. Oh, yes, that was certainly true. This business about scientific human beings is extremely odd, because all scientists know that other scientists are human beings. The scientists, if I may say so, are much more social creatures than writers. Writers are somewhat solitary. When you think about it, if you look at their way of life, it was almost with reluctance that they go and mix with their fellow men, although they obviously have to do it to get something to write about. But if you walk around one of the labs here, or even in the theoretical things, you'll find people in groups all the time. And they're not just sitting there not talking to each other. I mean, they may be not talking, they're not talking all the time, but they are interacting. And it's well known in labs that some people can't get on, and nothing you can do, you just have to keep them in somewhere separate because of some reasons of temperament. And for other reasons, you find you have a group of people and perhaps two or perhaps three of them get on extremely well in the ways you wouldn't necessarily have predicted. So these social interactions are very important. And everybody, I mean, it's part of the scientist's stock in trade to know about the character of other scientists. You see, I mean, how reliable they are and so forth, whether they're paranoid or, and all sorts of other qualities, whether they're a good person to go out and have a drink with in the evening and so on. That's what you have to know about scientists, and that's why people go to meetings. They go to meetings not only to hear about new scientific results, but to get an impression of the personality of the person who's doing the work. It's much easier to do that directly than actually reading the papers, because the papers are written in this funny style which almost leaves the personality out. And yet the personality is one of the most important things, because some people, you learn, are very reliable, and some people also, and others are not. And some people have bright ideas, and some people always have crazy ideas and things of this type. But you'd be surprised, just talking to a person for a few minutes, how much easily you can assess all that kind of thing. So scientists know that other scientists are human or not, but the general public has this extraordinary picture, which I don't know where it came from. And I think it comes from overhearing scientists talk. Because they talk in this strange jargon, in this sort of inhuman sort of way. Therefore, they must be inhuman. That's what the thing is. Actually, if you hear two scientists talking, they don't really talk like that much of the time. They may talk it when a layman overhears them. But if you go to groups of scientists, they're usually quite jolly, I would say. They're also very dedicated in what they do. Some, for example, are known to be overambitious. And some people are known to be rather quiet and retiring, and so on. It's very important to know these things if you work in an area. You're obviously all trying to, you know, discover the secrets of nature, or however I like to put it. And in principle, you're all supposed to work together and help each other. And a lot of cooperation does go on in science, but there's necessarily a degree of rivalry. If, first of all, merely because of reputation, because people want to have the reputation. And unfortunately, it's usually the person who does something first who gets it. Not always. Sometimes somebody will do something first and some will come along and do it very much better. But in general, it's the person who does it first. So there is this element of a race that comes into it. And some people are a lot more competitive than others. Some people are over-competitive. They have what's called Nobelitis. It looks as if they're trying too hard to get the Nobel Prize. That is thought highly regarded. and so you get this strange mixture of cooperation and rivalry. You get it to some extent, you know, between the armed forces, which are supposed to cooperate, but nevertheless have a degree of rivalry. I mean, the Air Force against the Navy and the Army and so on. There's always that sort of tension there, or even one regiment against another regiment in the army. So it's what you would find in most walks of life, but the general public is apt to overstress, I think, the competitive nature and not recognize how much cooperative work there is. People, you know, exchanging ideas, giving each other material and so on. Usually it's acknowledged, it's polite to acknowledge it or make the person a co-author if they've done substantial part, a significant part of the work and so on. Very difficult to convey the exact balance. And unfortunately, it's got more competitive recently because there are more scientists and they're more good scientists and the techniques are better. And many of them are where there's support. But because they've grown so much, they now need large sums of money, even in biological sciences, where they don't need enormously expensive apparatus like these super colliders, whatever it may be. But they do need apparatus and things, and that's becoming an appreciable part or a noticeable part of the national budget. So you can't go on increasing indefinitely. It's unclear just what level science should be supported, because you can argue from different points of view. I think, as one remarked earlier, that unless you're very keenly interested and fairly motivated and I would say almost dedicated, the frustrations and the difficulties, although of course there are rewards, but the frustration and the difficulties are such that if you aren't motivated that way, we'd be well advised not to go into the field. Might just go away and do something else, like make money or whatever you want to do. Well, you must notice that people who make a lot of money are people who are interested in making money. They don't even need the money, usually. They go on making the money when they've got masses of money. So it's just the same thing again. If you want to make money, you have to be really interested in making money. Same thing with science. And I'm sure it's true if you want to be a first-class musician, either as a performer or as a composer or anything else, or a painter. You have to have a strong motivation to do it. You have to feel that's the thing I really want to do and I don't want to be bothered with other things. I'm not sure all careers like that. It's a much more relaxed way if you have some rather simple, more routine sort of job. And it has the characteristics that you work from 9 to 5, whatever it is, and when you go home, that's the end of that. And you have the weekends off. You don't have this feeling every weekend you ought to be doing some work. although you should resist that because he shouldn't work all the time. But so, I mean, there are other ways of life, and it is more difficult. This is one one saw in the generation of the 60s. There were so many opportunities that people who didn't have a strong drive didn't know what to choose. Now, they often had difficulties in that way. Whereas if they, you know, it probably didn't matter what they chose as long as they made the choice. But if they kept dithering and wondering whether they should do this or the other and so on, they didn't necessarily perform as well as it. The most exciting thing was seeing the structure. No doubt about it at all. You must realize that although you have to have a certain merit to get a Nobel Prize, there's a certain amount of a lottery about it. I mean, there are lots, so I have certainly friends and colleagues who I think ought to have Nobel Prizes who haven't got it, and I can think of perhaps one or two have it who might perhaps not have been given it, you see. So what's odd about the Nobel Prize is that to people outside science, it represents a particular thing. You either have a Nobel Prize or you don't. Within science, it isn't that. You have good scientists. Some of them have got Nobel Prizes. Some of them don't have Nobel Prizes for what you might say trivial reasons. For example, Wigglesworth, who's the founded the subject of insect physiology, he really ought to have had a Nobel Prize, but it doesn't apparently come under insect physiology, doesn't come under physiology, you see. But, I mean, he's perfectly, he's at that stature. And there are certain, you can find other examples of people, or you could find people who just by the luck of somebody got a prize and theirs was a little bit too close to it, therefore they haven't got it. But to lay people, on the other hand, it is a sort of label, you see. And among scientists, they notice whether people have got Nobel Prizes, but it isn't thought to be the overwhelming thing. In fact, there's sometimes a negative feeling that once you've got a Nobel Prize, you won't do anything good after it. And there's a lot to be said for that. Most people don't do so much well after they got a Nobel Prize they did before, simply because they're getting older, I would say. I think it's certainly true in my case. The work I did before the Nobel Prize is better than the work I've done since. But I think younger people do the better work. And it's one of the things you learn in science, that the people from about 25 to 35 to 45 are the ones who are really doing the interesting work. And the more intellectual the subject is, the younger the age. This is particularly true when you go to theoretical physicists and mathematicians. They do their work usually very young. And the more experimental it is and the less intellectual it is, then the best work is done later, as a general rule. But of course, even that has exceptions. Mm-hmm.